Good morning, and I hope it's a wonderful morning wherever you are tuning in, as it is right here in Fairbanks, Alaska at First United Methodist Church. My name is Francis. I'm the choir director here, and we have a wonderful service ahead of us, so I hope you stay tuned in and listen to all of our wonderful music. We have a variety of music of all kinds, and we have Pastor Bob giving us a lovely sermon. We are welcoming you with our whole hearts, and we pray that you go away from this service with the love of God filled in your hearts just like ourselves.
Please join us as we sing "Today Is the Day."
Bring forth the royal dove. let us seek the beauty of soul that never fades, the treasure that rust cannot destroy, the satisfaction that will never sour with age. Let us seek the blessings of the Lord, for we have heard your invitation, Lord, to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness. Enable us now, as we have made time to listen, to leave behind our greediness and our blind ambitions, our anxieties and our tensions, our hurts and our sorrows. Replace these with good things instead. Amen. Now listen for a word from the Lord as I read from Psalm 86, verses 1 through 17. Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am devoted to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all day long. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call on you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my cry of supplication. In the day of my trouble I call on you, for you will answer me. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, the insolent rise up against me. A band of ruffians seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant. Save the child of your serving girl. Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Robots and robot dogs. This is Techno. represents technology of the 1990s. I remember when I ordered them, and every day just annoyed the church secretary with, where is it? Where is it? Where's my robot dog? Where's my robot dog? Well, finally my robot dog came. And yeah, like any robot dog, he would respond to touch and all that. And he could walk. He could even walk. There, I think he's walking. Except there was one problem. If he fell over, he lacked the ability to get back up. In fact, that is something that has plagued robots and robot engineers. I'm going to put him down here for a while. Was how to get robots back up on their feet again. You might be old enough to remember back in 2006, Honda's Asimo walking across the stage, walking up one step, then a second step, then a third step, then tumbling down into a pile of twisted metal. The problem is, again, of getting back up once knocked down. Robotic engineers, those are people who engineer robots, just to be clear, turned to the animal kingdom for ideas on how to resolve this problem, and they looked at turtles. Now, some turtles have big domes that just kind of make it easy for them to right themselves when they end up on their back. Others have very long necks that they can stick out to right themselves. But they finally decided maybe the best thing for robots is that they not fall over in the first place. Put a little ballast in the bottom. That's exactly what we're talking about when we look at Psalm 86, attributed to King David. In the psalm, things look pretty bleak. He's poor and needy, feels like his life is threatened, hated by the people around him. And there's a good chance maybe in the past year you felt that way too, once or twice, feeling as though things were out of your control, you were flat on your back and couldn't get up again. In those knocked over situations. And the robot world, again, eventually they might figure things out. But what about the psalmist here? The answer is yes, he can get back on his feet because he brings his circumstance to God. To God he brings his circumstance and his hope placed in God alone. Much of this psalm reads like a private prayer journal. He's crying out, kicking and screaming, flailing in prayer, anything to get God to right him, to turn him right side up again. Faith like that of a child, needing one greater than himself to stand. We can identify sometimes with this situation. Many times when we faced sickness, financial crisis, major life decisions, and found ourselves flailing about. In those moments, hopefully we can find the wisdom how to recover. Psalm 86 offers some help. The psalmist brings his messed up life before God in prayer. There's no pat or glib response. Too often we tend to live imagining as though God will come and fix everything. Or worse, that God is removed and uninterested. And many times we end up lamenting what we feel is God's absence rather than seek God's presence. How do we bring this level of honesty and need into our desperation toward God? This kind of honesty and hope, this real interaction with God requires. It doesn't shy away from the issues and the needs, nor does it assume a happily ever after. No, it shows a complete need. It stands in the tension and knows that from verse 7, you alone, God, will answer me. This mirror of the psalmist's cry, I am in need, you are my hope, you will answer me. I am devoted to you. the sermon, the psalm, is almost a directive, speaking and asking people to do as David did in that hour of need. Now, of course, robotic engineers would probably say, don't get knocked over in the first place. Put a little ballast in your bottom. Ballast, as you know, is something that if you put the weight of an object towards its bottom, it's less likely to get knocked over. It'll be easier to maintain its center of gravity. So you might be thinking, well, what do? Put weights on our shoes? But think about the ballast we have in our own life and in our own faith life. And first of all, the ballast of worship. Worship is where we go, where we hang our hope. Worship is that time that we praise God and God alone, the one who answers, the one who's there, the one who never fails. And the worship service reminds us that we truly believe what we're taught. It's worship that helps us to remember. It's that worship where we sing, we recite, we listen, we pray. And it's through these conversations with God, and then, of course, the conversations with one another, that we become anchored like a ballast to remind ourselves continually to whom we belong. But there's also more. There's the ballast of community. The teacher of Ecclesiastes reminds us of this. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift the other up. But woe to the one who is alone and falls and does not have another to help. A few weeks ago, we talked about the trees of the field and how some trees of the field were kind of weak, tend to be blown over. But those trees also tended to grow in clusters close to one another, as if to support one another. Or, if one does fall down, the other's keeping it from falling completely over. Years ago, living in Ferrum, Virginia, near Ferrum College, the football team had a very strange tradition. They would come out holding hands as they walked out on the field. Now, many teams, when they would walk out on the field, would come out individually and everyone would cheer, but the Ferrum team came out bound together. Now, there's different ideas where this tradition started. Some said that it started after somebody fell because their cleats got caught on the ground, and the reason for holding together was to keep from falling. Others say it's the very slogan of the college, that Ferrum, which also is a reference to iron, is stronger together. So there they would come out onto the field holding one another's hands, and of course, mostly the visitors would snicker and laugh. Then all of a sudden they would raise their hands up together and give out a tremendous roar. The laughing stopped. The church can be like that and hold together. And yes, people might snicker and point fingers, but when we rise up and roar, the church is that people. The people who are picking each other up and picking up others. It's where we find that strength in those relationships that we find here. Or, as in the past year we've learned, out there, outside of the building itself. And we were reminded again, the church is not a building. The church is a people. That though we couldn't gather for a while, we still held to one another and we still lifted one another up. It's that relationship that rooted us firmly as the wind blew around us. Christ's followers help one another and they lower their center of gravity and maintain that balance from being knocked over by life. That ballast of worship, of being reminded who they are and to whom they belong. And if they do fall, others pick them up. And they have the strength and the ballast to pick others up along the way. Like David, we are wise to hope in a God who delivers us, who helps us in those moments when we feel like we've been flipped upside down. We can choose the honesty of how we really feel. In David's psalm, he shouted out to the Lord, he lamented, he cried, but then he said, you alone, O God, are the one who can help. So we can choose that honesty, we can choose those relationships, we can choose worship, we can choose that community where we come together. This is what it means to be a follower of Christ, to maintain that ballast in the bottom as we go forth. We thank you. We thank you for joining us. We thank you for your support, your generous support of ministries here just below the Arctic Circle. We welcome your gifts. We welcome your calls. We welcome your presence. We are open, having services both indoors and out. And so, let us give thanks. O Lord, we give you thanks for the bounty you have given us. We give you thanks for the strength that comes from you and you alone. We thank you for all of those gifts. We thank you for being the ballast that holds us upright, holds us together in community. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join us in singing Give Thanks to the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Rejoice and dance and sing. Hallelujah.
singing, "This is Amazing Grace."
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? And Jesus breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
Thank you for having worshiped with us here at First Fairbanks United Methodist Church in Fairbanks, Alaska, just below the Arctic Circle. We hope you've enjoyed the traditional music, the praise music, and we want to remind you that we are worshiping in person with an indoor service at 9 a.m. and an outdoor service at 10 a.m. I'm not going to repeat the news of the day, but remind you that wherever you are, the Lord is ready to hear, just as he was ready to hear David's cry unto him and to lift him up to be his ballast. So, as we come together, let us enter into this time of prayer. O God, we offer our gratitude that you're always present with us. Instill us a desire to listen to others. Help us to listen with open hearts and open minds, that others might feel safe in our presence and welcomed into our family. Instill in us the spirit of serenity. Ground us, be our ballast, hold us upright. And let us lead in kindness and mercy as Jesus led those with him. And lead us together as we pray the way Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, as you go forth into your week, receive the benediction. Go forth now from this time to serve one another, empowered by the Spirit. Go forth to serve others into the company with all God's children to do God's work and God's will here on earth, that in loving and serving one another, in holding one another up, in finding our ballast in God and God's presence in our life, the kingdom of God may come through our work. In Jesus' name, amen.